Hello, vinyl community. Hope you're all doing well. I'm back to do another vinyl spins. This one I'm going to start out with someone I've really been getting more into, at least in terms of researching them, and I found a wonderful documentary, which I'll talk about here in a second. And that would be Lester Young. So, for those who do not know Lester Young, he left his mark on jazz and left his mark on pop culture, as far as we know it. He is a very unique figure in that artistically he never compromised. He had his own unique style. In fact, the way he held his saxophone, he held it like someone that would hold a flute. So, just very interesting. And in fact, his clothing, I mean, he's known for his pork pie hat, which, you know, was made infamous in the Charles Mingus song, Goodbye, Pork Pie Hat. And he was given the nickname Prez by Billie Holiday, who he named Lady Day, of course. And they had a very unique relationship that went sour at some point, and at least the people that were around him knew that they had this intense relationship. In fact, Billie Holiday said that she tried to model her voice after his saxophone. Her voice and his saxophone worked very well together. But in terms of pulp culture, you know, the term cool, that is so frequently used by a lot of people, came from Lester Young. He coined the term. He also coined the term bread, using bread for money. And he had some unique sayings, like when they were given a gig, he would say, well, how does this bread smell? Indicating, you know, how much are we going to get paid for this gig? And he would never break character. I mean, he would never interpret. So the club owner would, you know, have to know, or another band member would say, okay, how much are we going to get paid? So he was very unique because, you know, he never broke. And the documentary, which I found, is very good. I highly recommend it. It's a guy that was trying to do kind of a long-term documentary on his life, and he's soliciting donations, but he's had access to a lot of famous musicians, jazz musicians, and also non-jazz musicians. And I really recommend it because at least what he put out on YouTube is a 20-minute documentary, and I think if you're not really into music, even if you watch this, I think you'll get a little more involved in who he was and how he came to be. And, you know, one little tidbit that I learned from this documentary was I was not aware of, you know, he drove Harry Belafonte into his singing career. So I highly recommend checking out this jazz documentary. But Lester Young, unique original. I just happened to grab this one off my shelf. I think it was Wes had commented after listening to a Bessie Smith record about, you know, how bad some of the 78s can be, and, you know, sometimes the bad quality of the transfer to the 33 RPM LP format can take away from it. This can be close to one of those cases. This actually does sound pretty good. This is Charlie Parker Records. Just to show you what the label looks like. So Charlie Parker Records was a label that came out after Charlie Parker died. And it was founded by his widow because she was getting frustrated by so much bootleg Parker content being put out on the market. So she founded her own record label and was issuing Charlie Parker Records and other musicians. Now, this is not a must-have for Lester Young. I just happened to find it cheaply and it was sealed, nonetheless. But it's not bad, but you can tell that some of the singles on here were coming from 78s. And if you can find any of his stuff that he did on Verve, like there is an album called Prez. He also did a lot of work with Oscar Peterson. those albums are just fantastic. But this is Lester Young, and very influential on jazz history, and you know, a lot of historic saxophonists and jazz musicians really looked up to him. So I can't recommend checking out the documentary just to highlight some of, you know, the people that did meet him and knew him, some of their stories about it. So the next thing I have to show is this guy, which I featured in my last video. So I managed to clean this guy up, and I was really excited. I want to give it a listen, and this is very, very interesting. So this is traditional Swedish songs done in kind of a big band jazzy style. So if you're into big band type music, times it had a Henry Mancini feel to it with some wonderful jazz soloing. This is Bengt Arne Wallin, and it features Sahib Shahab. And you can, I want to see, you could see him here, right there in that photo. So this is a period during the 60s when a lot of jazz musicians just could not get gigs or make money in the United States. So they went to Scandinavia, they went to Europe to play, and definitely worth checking out. I'll include a link down below so you can sample it. So another thing that I like to show, which was given to me by Jonas, was Jazz på Svenska. And this is by Jan Johansson. And I can't recommend this enough. There's a lot of great jazz music that was coming out of Scandinavia and Europe in the 60s, and this is one of the highlights for me. I was first exposed to this album in the 90s, and this is just a piano and a bass player, but the two are so in sync with one another, and it's moody. It creates this wonderful atmosphere. And you know, if there's a must-own album from the Swedish jazz catalog, I can't recommend this one enough. So I'm going to include a sample to this down below. Now the next one, I got to thank David Sequoia Flame, because he was really hyping Flying Dutchman. So I just happened to come across this. Saw the Flying Dutchman label, and I had to grab it. So when I show you the cover, don't get too excited, but it is kind of interesting. So this is Black, Brown, and Beautiful by Oliver Nelson. And the cover, yes, it is quite striking, but the music, it really deals with civil rights issues. And it really resonates with what is going on in the United States today. And it's sad to say that some things haven't changed. And that, you know, it's really kind of a concept album, talking about segregation and oppression of the blacks. And, you know, it's orchestral. Oliver Nelson was a multi-instrumentalist, but he was also known for his arranging and composing skills. And you know, he did arrangements for folks like James Brown and a few other 70s soul musicians. He did some soundtrack work. He died in 75 of a heart attack, because he was really doing a lot of soundtrack work, and I think the pressure just kind of got to him. But this is wonderful. It's a great, great concept album. Kind of the cover, though, is kind of a contrast, because it ends kind of on a lighter note, and I think it's trying to reflect that, hey, black people are beautiful. Yes, they are beautiful. But thank you, David Sequoia Flame, because, you know, if it wasn't for you showing these albums, you know, I probably would have passed on it. I mean, Oliver Nelson, yeah. He did some great work on Prestige, and he did some stuff on Elm Pulse. But, you know, if I saw this in the bin and I saw some Elm Pulse albums or Prestige albums, I'd probably grab those over this one. But thank you for introducing me to the Flying Dutchman line. It's great. Next one is by request by a commenter named Jimmy M. So Jimmy M and I both subscribe to Vinyl Me Please, and I was introduced to Vinyl Me Please by the Vinyl Rewinds channel. And this is not the first album I picked up from Vinyl Me Please. I think it was the second album that I got through the club. And this is Hot Chip's fifth album that was done on Domino. Very interesting. If you're into 80s synth pop, this will probably be right up your alley. But I felt that at least the first LP, it's a two LP set. The first LP was, the songs started to frustrate me because they were all the same tempo. The singer's voice, I want to say is Alexis Taylor. It can be a little bit off key, and you know, sometimes I like off key singers, but this album just didn't work for me. I mean, I don't think it was as good as One Life Stand, which is the album that preceded it and was put out on Parlophone. This one was put out on Domino, and these are pressed at United, and everyone knows how I feel about United. They have their issues, but you know, these are great. Didn't have any pressing flaws. They played all through. But I think Vinyl Me Please is just, I'd be curious to see how they operate. It comes with a nice insert that you wouldn't have gotten in the original. I think they are just asking people to press up more. And you know, they're putting in some cool stuff, cool inserts. But I do not consider this album essential. Now, if you want a sample track, which I'll include below, I think the best track here was Flutes, and that's probably the most well-known. And to me, that was the most unique one because it uses a sample and it kind of builds up. But a lot of the songs were fairly, I don't know how I want to say, redundant. And maybe I just need to spin a little bit more to see if it grows on me. I do not consider this essential in the Hot Chip catalog. The other nice thing about Vinyl Me, if you haven't seen the Vinyl Rewinds channel, is that you know they have this nice kind of fold-over as a nice cocktail recipe that they put off here on the side. And you know they do limited print runs. I don't know how many, but this one just happens to be from June, has the initials of the person that packed it. Yeah, very nice spine. So kind of a unique club, very interesting. I'll be curious to see how long I stick with it. Jimmy M told me their next album is going to be reggae, so they mix it up a bit. So you know, one of the things that excited me about them is I saw that they did Ben Webster Soulville, which, you know, I was informed that they have additional copies, so I'm trying to get one of their copies to see what it sounds like. But anyways, I'll stick with them for a little bit longer to see, you know, if I happen to enjoy more of their releases. If not, I may just kind of stop continuing to subscribe because I don't want to waste my money. Next album, which I was spinning, is the new issue of Air's Talkie-Walkie. So all of Air's catalog got reissued. If you don't know who Air is, they are a wonderful French electronic duo, and they've been together since the late 90s. This is either their fourth or fifth studio album, and I think it's one of the better ones. You know, Moon Safari, their intro album is one of their best in my opinion, along with Virgin Suicides, but this is next up, and this is a very nice press. I think this was pressed in Europe on 200 gram vinyl, A very nice insert. Came with a download code on 180 gram, as you can see from the Hype sticker. And I can't say for sure. I want to say it was pressed at Palace, at least. But I can't say for sure. I know it was pressed somewhere in Europe. But if you haven't heard Air, what I like about this is that there's a nice flow to this album. Unlike Hot Chip, I mean, not everything is at the same tempo. They've mixed it up. They used a lot of classical instrumentation with this. Sometimes they'll bring in guest singers just to mix it up. So Talkie Walkie, can't recommend it enough. Another album I've been spinning is Morcheeba's first album. Morcheeba is a, again, they'd say electronic, but it's kind of, they use real instrumentation. You know, it's orchestral, it's a little bit loungy, it's a little bit trip hop at times. Wonderful singer, and this is The Big Calm. And this guy was mastered at Abbey Road Studios. And it's on the Indochina label. And I want to say it's probably done by the same pressing plant that did the Air. If it's not Palace, it's one of the better ones. Usually Palace has a distinct inscription in their dead wax, but I can't tell. If you happen to know who pressed this, please let me know. No download code with this one, though. If you haven't heard this, this is really good. One of the tracks that I'll put a link down to is Part of the Process, which is one of their better known tracks. Now, the last thing that I've been spinning recently is Howlin' Wolf, Off the Record. And this is a Friday Music reissue. Now, Howlin' Wolf is just, you know, he's one of those essential blues artists that I think you have to go for. A lot of the tracks here were written by Willie Dixon, who's another famous blues composer. The Friday Music reissues are really well done, done on 180 gram vinyl. They do their best to reproduce the logo or label as best as they can. Of course, you got the Friday Music there off to the left. And, you know, Chess Records, they are like Blue Notes in terms of collectability. The early 60s ones can go for a lot of money if they're in really good condition. The sad thing about the Chess catalog is that, you know, they were bought out by MCA, and all the originals went to an archive in California, which also had all the original Impulse recordings, and a lot of good pop stuff from the 60s that, you know, that the archive burnt to the ground, and, you know, all the master tapes for the Chess records were lost. And so, you know, they're using the best copies that they can possibly find for this. And this was mastered by Kevin Gray, and I can't recommend this enough. This is a an essential blues album. Of course, you know, one of the classic tracks here is Spoonful, which, you know, classic blues song that was really made famous by Kareem. So that's what I've been spinning. Got any thoughts, comments, things that maybe I just didn't get right, please shoot me a comment down below, and have a great week, everyone.